Jim McAdams. I'm the director of the Nanovic Institute. And one of the events that we sponsor, about which we are the most proud, is called the Nanovic Forum. The Nanovic Forum is a brilliant idea by our donors, Bob and Liz Nanovic, to bring really distinguished, but also really interesting people to Notre Dame, who just had unique and enlightening perspectives about the universe. And what we try to do in these visits is to connect our visitors with many, many different people, rather than just focusing on one segment of the academy. And you'll see tonight what I mean by this. We're interested in bringing the different schools of the university, students from different disciplines and majors together to think in new and innovative ways about our common quest for wisdom. Past speakers for the Nanovic Forum have included Lord Patton of Barnes, Chancellor of the University of Oxford and the last British Governor of Hong Kong, Horst Köhler, President of Germany, and President Köhler will be with us again in the fall. He'll spend several weeks with us and teach, of course, Anna Sopocka, former Prime Minister of Poland, and most recently, the German film director, Margareta von Trotta. I am now, in the spirit of moving along to more interesting people, pleased to introduce our Dean of Science, Mary Galvin, who will introduce our speaker.
I want to thank you all for coming and thank the Nanovic Institute for sponsoring this. It's a real thrill and honor to have our guest tonight. I promise to keep the introduction short, so I will. Professor Heuer is former Director-General of CERN. He was there from 2009 to 2015. He's currently the president of the German Physical Society. If you go in and look at his bio, there's many more wonderful things I could tell you about him. He's been a true leader in science, and it's an honor to have him here.
Thank you very much for sticking to the short introduction. Okay, very good. Yeah, today I want to talk science, bridging cultures and nations by exploring the early universe. Okay, now if we want to explore the early universe, what do you need? Well, you need large experiments, you need large infrastructures, you need international collaboration. And international collaboration means you need trust between the partners. And the word trust nowadays is very, very important. So all this is being, for all this, it needs your touch, obviously. All this needs an institute like CERN. No, I think I can manage. I stay closer and closer. It's called non-remote control. Okay, let's see. Maybe the other side is better. Okay, it needs an institute like CERN. The mission of CERN is fourfold. First of all, to push back the frontiers of knowledge, like unraveling parts of the secrets of the Big Bang. What was matter like within the first moments of the universe existence? in order to do this, you need to develop new technologies for accelerators, for detectors, but also for information technology. And I guess you all know that the web was born at CERN. It was 1989. The web was born at CERN. Today, at CERN, it's a grid computing which is going into the cloud computing nowadays in the private sector. And of course, medical applications. No, pushing back the frontiers of knowledge, developing new technologies means you can train scientists and engineers of tomorrow. And this is very, very important to do that nowadays. And you cannot do it alone. You need many, many different brains, many, many different hands. It's a very nice way to unite people from different countries and different cultures. So CERN was founded in 1954 by 12 European states. At that time you could say science for peace. The whole idea started 1949, a few years after the Second World War. And what did you need? You needed a handful of visionary scientists and a handful of visionary diplomats getting together and trying to bring Europe out of the ruins through science, through research. And it was obvious that cannot be done within the national borders. That's impossible. The countries are too small. You have to get beyond the national borders. You have to get people together who were, a few years earlier, not at peace with each other. And it worked. It took only 5 years to create CERN. Fantastic. And that was the first accelerator at CERN. He's brought here to CERN early in the early 50s. At that time, the accelerators were pretty small. And I like the escort. So it's fantastic. We have still this accelerator at CERN as a museum. And whoever gets to CERN, look at that. It's a fantastic museum, a fantastic film there about the history of CERN. That's the accelerator complex today. It doesn't fit onto a single transparency in principle. It's now around 50 kilometers of tunnel, 50 kilometers of accelerator. And our flagship, of course, is the Large Hadron Collider. But we have many, many different small accelerators which all have a purpose from decelerating antiprotons up to accelerating protons. So today, CERN has grown from 12 to 22 member states. I don't present here the member states, I will come back to that at the end of the talk, when I talk more about science for peace today. But we have around, well, I can no longer say we, because I'm no longer responsible for CERN. But still, I will use the word we, okay? Because you still feel very much emotionally attached and also scientifically attached to this laboratory. Around 3,700 staff and other paid personnel, and more than 12,500 scientific users who come in order to do their research. So CERN is in principle, it's a European intergovernmental organization, but it's globally used. Because science has to be free for everybody who passes the peer review. So it's an infrastructure. We have many more engineers than scientists at CERN. It's an infrastructure belonging to all of its member states. And it's an example, since more than 60 years, an example of what Europe and its partners can achieve when they are working together. So you see here, 1954, when Europe was getting reconstructed, the first session of the Council, 1980, East meets West, visit from Beijing. Today, the LHC brings together more than 8,000 scientists from some 100 nationalities. So the key message here is from the very beginning of the existence of CERN, it was a peaceful cooperation at the forefront of science, independent of cultural and national differences. That's very, very important. We speak one language, science. Today, it's really going from a European to a global collaboration. So CERN is breaking the walls between cultures and nations since 1954. And this gives you the distribution of all the CERN scientific users by nationality. It's a spot check of September 2016. And you see, it's a tremendous amount of nationalities, around 3/4 are coming from the member states, but 1/4 are coming from all over the world, and you see that all continents are involved. And we have scientists coming from all over the world to do their science. And for people who don't have very good eyes, but I realize that this is pretty good here. It doesn't work here. You have to do something on your own. The USA has 1,170 scientists coming to the CERN. So we are one of the biggest US labs. However, the US is not a member of CERN. So you get the science for free. Not quite, because you are very strong partners in the experiments, and without, frankly speaking, without the US participation in the experiments would not work. I have to say. Very, very essential. Okay, so you see, all these people are coming because science is a universal language. And this is the age distribution of these scientific users. And you see, it peaks at 26. So these are the PhD students, that's 26. And today, so it's a very nice distribution because it's a very healthy distribution. It's mainly dominated by young people. Well, it's a nice distribution, otherwise I would not show it, of course. But you see, it's also a very nice one because the school eyes is 85 here. And actually that statistics was done 5 years ago. I know that people are now 5 years old. However, why do I say that? Because at that time, the LHC only started up, so that there are not so many PhD students in the LHC. Now, today, there are more than 3,000 PhD students working on the LHC experiments. That means the peak would even be higher at 26. A very healthy distribution. Okay, why are the people coming? Because they want to address the scientific challenge to understand at least part of the very first moments of our universe after the Big Bang. When the universe started as a tremendously hot, very small point, and it expanded over roughly 14 billion years to today's size of 10 to the 28 centimeters. I'm in the US, maybe I can nonetheless make the joke, okay. Can you imagine 10 to the 28 centimeters? You can imagine? Then you know. Maybe I can help you. If you replace the centimeters by dollars, you have roughly the budgetary deficit of the US. Okay. Something like that. Okay. Anyhow, so how can you now investigate the history of the universe? Well, you can do it at a large scale. Astrophysics, for example, astroparticle physics, uses telescopes to look into the history of the universe. Okay? Now there you have a problem, because if you look with photons, with light, into the history of the universe, you run against a ball of roughly 380,000 years after the Big Bang. Because in the first 380,000 years of the existence of the universe was so hot, so energetic, that no stable atoms could form. That means all light quanta were immediately absorbed again, so there was nothing coming out as information. But 380,000 years is pretty close to the Big Bang. Yeah? However, you can do it better. And you can do it better by looking at the small dimensions. Particle physics uses microscopes to reproduce the conditions of the early universe. So that's the big difference. Astrophysics uses telescopes. Particle physics uses microscopes. Astrophysics looks into the history. Particle physics reproduces the conditions. These are the two differences. And I try to show it here again on this ruler. You have on the right-hand side the universe as today, on the left the Big Bang. You have the telescopes on the large scale, you have the microscope on the small scale, and the LHC is the super microscope, the most powerful microscope in the world, at least on Earth. And the Large Hadron Collider project is a super microscope with four huge eyes. It's the highest energy accelerator with four huge detectors. And it's getting closest to the Big Bang, less or equal around 10 to the minus 12 seconds. So it's breaking the wall of this hidden universe to get as close as possible to the early universe. Now, what have we learned in the time of the past roughly 50 years as our accelerators about the building blocks of nature? And let's see what we have learned here. And that's our so-called standard model of particle physics. The world is built up out of quarks, three families of two quarks each here, up, down, charged, strange, top, bottom, and three families of leptons, electron, muon, and tauon, together with the neutrinos. The three families of this, and the heaviest, heaviest known elementary particle is the top quark. It's as heavy as a gold atom, but it's point-like. Again, very difficult to imagine a point-like particle as heavy as a gold atom. Now that's very nice, but we need, in order to describe the visible world, to describe us, you, etc., only three particles: the up quark, the down quark, and the electron. You all are composed only out of three particles. Two up and one down quark makes the proton, two down and one up quark makes the neutron. And that makes them, these two make them nucleus, and the electrons are needed for the atoms. So that's the, the visible world. Now, these three families on these particles have to interact with each other, they have to talk to each other, and they do this through the force particles. And these are the force particles here, the photons are responsible, are the carriers of the electromagnetic force, which takes, keeps the atoms together. The gluons are keeping the quarks in the nuclear, in the protons and neutrons, and that, and keep them in the nuclei, so that's for the carriers of the strong force. The W's and Z bosons are the carriers of the weak force, which describe is responsible for some of the processes in the sun. And the standard model, this standard model is fantastic. It is really fantastic. It describes all the visible world with very high precision. That's on the one hand fantastic, on the other hand, as you will see, very frustrating. However, before the LHC started, one of the crucial questions was left open, and this is, how do these elementary particles acquire mass? And all, most of these particles, not the photon, not the gluon, all the other particles, they have a certain mass. I told you how heavy, how massive the top quark is. Now you might ask, why must I be interested how these particles acquire mass? Well, you better are. Because only with massive particles you can form composite matter. With only massless particles you could not form composite matter. So for you it's a vital question. Why and how these particles are mass? Okay? And we have the answer for that. Okay? Well, you know that already in principle. So this last cornerstone of the standard model was this question: what is the origin of mass of elementary particles? And the solution, a possible solution to this, that you define the mass as a property of particles with a certain energy E to move with a velocity normalized to the light velocity C, which is along this formula. So if the mass is zero, then this one is zero, so the velocity is equal to the light with the velocity of light. The heavier, the more massive the particle with the same energy, the lower the velocity. So what did these six people do? They introduced a scalar field. We are here at the university, I guess all of you know what a scalar is. Nobody dares to say no, okay? So I don't have to explain it. And particles acquire the mass through the interaction with the scalar field. That means the mass is independent of any direction. So particles acquire mass through the interaction with this field, and the self-interaction of the field is the so-called Higgs particle, called after one of these inventors, Peter Higgs. Now, for those who are not doing particle physics, this sounds very abstract, very difficult. Agree? Yes, okay. Okay. Now, this is a party of journalists. After the code buffet, this is empty, because then they are equally distributed in the room. They are scalar feet. Okay? There's no definite direction. On the left-hand side is a door. I go in into that door and want to go out on the other side. The journalists don't know me. I go through with velocity of light. They don't know me. Nobody interacts with me. I'm massless. Okay? Now somebody comes in whom they know. Of course, journalists are curious. They want to interact with this person. This person acquires mass. Okay? The more known that person, the more massive. That's easy. Now, what is the self-interaction? I open the door, and I whisper a rumor into the room. Okay? Again, journalists are curious. What did he say? That's the self-interaction of the field. There's no other particle. That's the Higgs-Boson. Okay? And then, of course, it decays again, and then other people come to it. And so this is the way particle physicists imagine the Higgs mechanism. You agree? It's pretty easy without formulas. Okay. So the question is now, has the LHC answered this crucial question? That means, did we find a Higgs boson, the last missing cornerstone of the standard model? Well, there are many more key questions of particle physics open. So what happened to antimatter? We are in a matter-dominated universe. Yeah? What happened to antimatter? Are we really living in three space and one time dimension? Or are there more dimensions? And this question, what is dark matter? What is dark energy? And you see here, the standard model just describes nearly 5% of the matter energy density of the universe. 5%, 95% are dark. Dark matter, 1/4 roughly, and dark energy, roughly 3/4 of the dark universe. So dark matter clumps like normal matter, and the dark energy drives the universe apart in all directions in the same way. So again, the scalar field. So there's this tiny question, what is dark matter? What is this dark energy? Now, you always can have a dream, okay? And with the Large Hadron Collider, I think we are entering, it's clear we are entering unknown territory, because we are opening a window into completely unknown fields. But it could be also a window into the dark universe. So the Large Hadron Collider project is situated in the region of Geneva. It's one of the largest scientific instruments ever built. Accelerator 27 kilometer circumference, 100 meter. Underground collides volumes with reproduced conditions a millionth of a millionth, that means 10 to the minus 12 seconds after the birth of the universe. And you do that 40 million times a second. Quite often. And in this, and we register in four huge experiments what happens in these collisions. I don't now go too much into this physics, but I want to show you that this is in principle an impossible project to do. Because to design and to construct such a project, many thousands of technicians, of engineers and physicists from all over the world, from different cultures, from many different disciplines, had to develop new technologies and to develop new engineering concepts. And they had to work and still have to work together over decades. This is what we designed. So the question is, can that work? And there are two aspects to it. One, of course, is the human aspect, and the other one is the technology aspect. So in the human aspect, it works. And this is just one photo from the CERN open days, 3 years ago, I think. These are Pakistani welders explaining to visitors from India the welding process applied for the LHC interconnections for the high carbons. It's the only photo I have, but I can tell you, we have experiments where Indian scientists and Pakistani scientists are working together. So it's just one example. We have many more of these examples. So the human aspect works, because everybody wants to get a result out. We are talking science. But technologically, it's difficult. We need the fastest racetrack on the planet, because we will have trillions of protons, which are bunched, packeted, in up to nearly 3,000 packets, which run around the 27 kilometer ring in opposite directions over 11,000 times a second, traveling at a high speed. They are kept on track by more than 1,200 superconducting dipole magnets with a magnetic field of 8 Tesla. When the idea of LHC came up, these magnets, types of magnets, did not exist yet. So you need quite some time to develop them. We need to create one of the coldest places in the universe, because with an operating temperature of about minus 271 degrees Celsius, just 1.9 degrees above absolute zero, the LHC is colder than outer space. It uses 80 tons of superfluid helium to cool the magnets down to that temperature. Okay, if you have this, then you have to capture and accelerate and hold the beam of these trillions of protons. So these 3,000 packets, they are pencils, sub-millimeter width, at a distance of 7.5 meters, with over 10 to the 11 protons per packet, at the speed close to the speed of light. And during the acceleration, the energy of the beam has increased by approximately 300 megajoules within 20 minutes, during which the tiny protons have a distance further than the round trip to the sun. Of course, always in the thing, but this is a challenge. And if 300 megajoules doesn't tell you very much, well, the energy stored in the two beams, that is of course more than that, 720 megajoules. And 700 megajoules melts 1 ton of copper. But if you make this tiny mistake, the accelerator is done. And we have several years to work on. Because we don't want to do that. So if there's any indication that the beam gets a little bit out of control, you have to dissipate the 700 megajoules in 88 microseconds. That means you have to produce 8 terabytes. Or 90 kilotons of DDT per beam. So, controls is key. So, finding controlled feedback loops, maintaining position and stability of the packets. Sensors have been developed in order to precisely determine the position, and all this complex equipment must remain working faultlessly for many hours at a time. And we should not forget that the energy stored in the magnet system is around 10 gigajoules. And 10 gigajoules corresponds to flying at 700 kilometers per hour with an Airbus A380 or with an aircraft carrier with 55 kilometers per hour. You better take care of all this, yeah, if you want to run for several years. So once we have mastered all the engineering challenges, the accelerator looks like this. It's ready to go. But now we want to do physics with these beams, okay? So we have the accelerator here, we have the proton beams running clockwise and anti-clockwise with the packets, nearly 3,000 packets, hundreds of protons. Then the protons are, then you take the two packets into a collider. What happens? Nothing happens. What you have to do is you have to squeeze them, you have to focus the beam so that some of the protons collide. So the way we focus, roughly 30 to, at the moment it's 30, 40 protons which collide in one packet collision. So the protons are colliding, and then what is the interaction happens between the constituents of the protons, the quarks, and the gluons. And then we have to detect what happened in these collisions through the measurement of the particles which come out of these collisions. That means in this, we have the coldest place in the universe, but in these conditions, we deal with the hottest spots in the galaxy. Because when the two beams of photons collide, they generate huge temperatures, much hotter than in the heart of the sun. However, in a miniature space, that's the point. It's not the energy, it's the energy density. Energy divided by the area of the photon. So that brings us so close to the Big Bang. So we have then four huge detectors which register what happens in these collisions. And as you all know, Notre Dame is participating in the CMS experiment. So CMS has roughly 3,000 members from around 40 countries. You see the experiment in India, let me say, this is a normal human being. Could also be a physicist. 3,000 members, which means at least 300, 400 full professors, which means at least 300, 400 egos. They have to work together. So it's also sociology. Because it's the large international collaboration. It's a place where people learn and have to work together. It's collaboration and competition at the same time. Yeah? You accept diversity and learn to use it as an opportunity. I think it influences the way of thinking and planning at the general level. Experience in such large collaborations can be used by individuals and in other fields. It's management through common goals. It's management by convincing partners. It's amazing. It really works, independent of any cultural and national difference. Sometimes I think it's a miracle. But we are physicists, so. Okay. So, large international collaborations are a great training ground, by the way, for academia and private sector for today's challenging global politics and markets. So you learn to accept and to give. It's give and take. That's the key message. There are also other aspects. These ones. These are brass shells of ammunition. One of the detector parts used in the CMS detector uses World War II brass shell casings from the Russian Navy in making some of its components. I think it's for the Patrol. And to my mind, it's a much better use of technology. ATLAS also has around 3,000 members. And I have to show you that there's another big experiment, not only CMS. And there's a photo during the early construction phase. And this empty space, all this empty space needed to be equipped with instrumentation. And then it looks like this on the right hand side, to arrive at the final detector. And the whole volume, the same is true for CMS, is now filled with more than 100 million sensors of very different kinds developed in more than 40 countries. Arriving at an average measurement accuracy of 0.1 millimeter over the entire volume, that means it's the thickness of a hair over the entire volume. Measuring precision. So now we have constructed the accelerator and the detectors. What's next? Well, the protons collide inside of this tube in the heart of the detector, which is on the left-hand side. Can this work? Well, now yes. Otherwise, I would not stand. So 1 billion pairs of protons interact per second. In these collisions, hundreds of billions of particles are produced, again, every second. That's a very harsh environment. Then we are looking for new physics, for physics signals, which are 10 to 11 orders of magnitude below the rate of all the signals together. Now 10 to 11 orders of magnitude means this. The number of human beings is of the order of 10 to the 10. So the LHC detector's job is like trying to find the one person in all of humanity who meets a special set of criteria. And that not only once, but many times, because you need the statistics. It works beautifully. It's fantastic. So the study of LHC data will allow us to address some of the key questions which I mentioned. What is the primordial state of matter after the Big Bang? Have we found this? Will we ever find a reason why antimatter and matter should not completely destroy each other? And will we find the particles that make up the mysterious dark matter? And what's dark energy? So all this, these questions can be addressed. And you see, I'm not a diplomat. I'm not saying that they can be answered. They can be addressed. Now, a short word on the Higgs particle. And that, of course, I have selected CMS because it's a very nice event. So this is a signature how a Higgs particle could be seen in the detector. The Higgs particle would be created and decays immediately again. I think its lifetime is 10 to the minus 20 seconds. So very short, but it decays immediately into other particles. In this case, into two photons. Now, life is not very easy, because there are many processes where you could have two photons from the stellar model, not coming from the Higgs, and then it would look like this. You take the two photons together, you calculate the mass from which these two photons would come, and then you have a distribution like this. This is if there is no Higgs particle. If there is a Higgs particle, then you must see an accumulation of these events at a certain mass, and that's it.
Yeah.
That was the discovery signal, and that is in enlargement. This was the significance of it during, in 2012. This gave the Nobel Prize in Physics 2013 to Peter Higgs and François Henri, two of the six. And the amazing story about these two guys here is they came up with their theory 48 years before the discovery. And they have never met until that moment. It's amazing. I could not imagine that particle physicists would not meet. But these are theorists. They don't need to go to the conference. And, okay, CERN was very nicely in the citation here, referred to the discovery of the predicted fundamental particle by the two experiments. Large particle. So I was very pleased at that time. But this Higgs particle is special because all matter particles have a spin. 1/2 in our nomenclature. It doesn't matter. But all force particles have a spin. They have one spin 1. So they all have a spin. The Higgs particles are spin 0. They have no spin. They don't turn around themselves. They are scalars. And so the Higgs is neither matter nor force. It is just different. And it's the only, the first and only fundamental scalar ever discovered. Okay? So why should it be the only one? Why should the H-boson be the only one that's at the moment we only know this one? But the LHC can search for such scalars and investigate them if there are more. So this is an intriguing question. Is there only one scalar fundamental particle? Yes or no? This is very important to investigate. So the Higgs-Boson discovery is only the beginning. What's next? Is it the Higgs-Boson and only the only one? Or is it one of many? And if we measure with precision the properties of the discovered one, then they could give information on dark matter. It could maybe give first indications of dark energy, because dark energy is a scalar, also a scalar. Okay, let's have a look on the dark matter. Again, this photo, this picture you remember. Einstein gave his mass here. Now suppose there is a dark matter particle in the room. Yeah? Then some journalists might see that dark matter particle and turn their attention away from Einstein to the dark matter particle, which means the mass of Einstein becomes different. The properties of Einstein would be different. So that can be very tiny. So you have to measure all the properties of the Higgs boson, of particles, and of the Higgs boson in order to investigate that. So the Higgs boson could interact with particles which constitute the dark matter. This will change the properties, even tiny, of the Higgs boson and of other particles. So we have to measure all the properties of this boson as precisely as possible. So the discovery was only the beginning. What's next? Well, is it a Higgs boson or is it the Higgs boson of the standard model? And as I said, the properties could give information on dark matter, could give first hints on dark energy. You see how less certain I am on the second part. So at least my understanding of the universe is about to change. So this is the exciting time in particle physics. So this is why we have set up a scientific program, and now I can say we, because we did it already during my mandate, until around 2035, with upgrades, roughly 10 years, presenting new energy engineering challenges. So we have 20 years of program in front of us. Now I come back to the question, to the point which I made at the very beginning. To design, construct and explore the LHC, you need all this. I mentioned this already. It's a marvel of engineering, it's a marvel of science, and it works beautifully. But it does more than that. The key message here is sustainable development needs trust. Trust between everybody involved, all the people involved. And this brings me to the point of science for peace. Because peace you can only have if you trust each other. And the example, since over 60 years, is CERN. You saw this already here. But I bring this, I show this slide again with two early examples. Negotiations between Israel and Germany on the science were taking place at CERN. It was a neutral count and it worked. So projects were working on, were worked out at CERN. And the Iron Curtain was permeated because people could go to CERN and could go to the Eastern Bloc countries at that time. So these were two very important missions beyond science by CERN in the early days. Now CERN today, I told you, 22 member states with around 12,500 scientific users with some 100 nationalities. And these are the member states, 22. These are associate states which will become members soon. And these are associate member states which have a lower financial burden but also lower rights. And these are applications for membership or associate membership. All these red ones came after 2010. Because 2010, we made a very important decision at CERN by redefining the E in CERN from Europe to everywhere. That means any country, any nation, independent of the geographical location, could become a member of CERN. It was not so easy, but he achieved it. And as a So Israel is the first member outside Europe. Romania is Europe. But then you see Cyprus, Serbia, Slovenia, Ukraine, Turkey, Pakistan, India, Russia. There are some countries in which are still not very much in Eastern Europe. But they all want to participate at CERN. And I can tell you, it works very well with these countries. So it is diplomacy through science, or science diplomacy, or whatever you call it. And now I have a new example, which is even more challenging. That's sesame. That's a synchrotron light for experimental science and applications in the Middle East. It's a synchrotron light source which is under construction in Annan, which is close to Amman in Jordan. The scientific purpose is to foster scientific and technological excellence in the Middle East and the neighboring countries. And hopefully prevent or reverse the brain drain. We don't prevent it so much, we have to reverse it. By enabling world-class scientific research in subjects, biology, archaeology, which is important for education, medical science, physics, chemistry, etc. This is what you can do with synchrotron radiation. That's a scientific aspect. But the other aspect is to build scientific and cultural bridges between diverse societies and to contribute to a culture of peaceful international cooperation in science. And now look at the member states. Pakistan, Iran, Turkey, Cyprus, Palestinian Authority, Israel, Egypt, Jordan, Bahrain. There's an aim, this panel. And they all were consistent. It's amazing. I can tell you in May I become the president of that council. And then I have to see that it still works when it's no longer under construction, but when they do science. That's a challenge. But okay, we have to try it then. We have to try to do that. Yeah? And I think if science can do it, who else? Who else can do it? Okay, so the whole thing is set up on the model of CERN because all the presidents of the councils are up to now previous CERN journalists. So there seems to be a need for such people. So SESAME will be the Middle East's first synchrotron light source. February 2016, the first of the 16 cells of the storage ring was installed. By the way, with a lot of help of CERN. I'm pretty proud of that we achieved that. The status of today is that beam is circulating, and 16th of May this year, the official opening will happen, and then at some stage, experiments can start. So this is another very nice example, hopefully a very good example for science for peace, and I think certainly I'm looking for the project for hope. So let's see. Let me end with something which takes all everything which I said on one transparency, essentially. And that's the last paragraph of an editorial which appeared in the Guardian in March 2015 after we switched on the LHC again at higher energy. So the main thing you have to read is that the partnership so far has spun off colossal technological and computing rewards, but that is not the point. The point is that Europe is working together in a thrilling intellectual exploration that can have no conceivable commercial or political payoff, but could, in some intangible way, enlighten all humankind. In these otherwise murderous and mean-spirited times, that is something to celebrate. It's still true. I think it has been true for quite some time, and it's still true. So the role of science, I think, is to innovate, to discover, to publish, and to share, and finally bring the world together. Thank you.
Extremely interesting. At this time in our program, well, I should say, the wonderful thing about your presence here is that you have an opportunity to speak to all of us. I'm not a physicist, and maybe I'll admit I was struggling just a little bit to keep up, but also the opportunity to meet with historians and philosophers and also artists. And in that spirit, we have a gift for you that I think everybody will find extremely interesting. Justin Trupiano, who is here, is a second year MFA student in the Masters of Fine Arts in Photography. And before we make the presentation, I have to struggle through what Justin does, so bear with me. Luckily, it's written down. Justin's work addresses unseen and inaccessible aspects of the universe. Using data-driven 3D renderings, he explores phenomena outside the visual spectrum as a way to address our limited empirical access, question the subjective nature of reality, and reevaluate how we locate ourselves within the context of the greater cosmos. So, you know, when it comes to big questions, I think that artists are posing them. Now, he's created an image for us, which I will describe. using the cosmic microwave background, using cosmic, but it's not the microwave that we all know, using cosmic microwave background data rendered three-dimensionally and mapped onto a sphere as if it were looking at the universe. The great thing is, I'm not sure what that means, but we can look at it. We can actually see this. And so we're delighted to present you as a memory of our visit. Why don't you turn this way? Justin, you can explain what we're looking at.
Yeah.
You are looking at, I don't see it all.
Well, it's so this is sort of the, from the WMAP survey that we saw earlier, sort of the edge of the universe, which is our, which is the cosmic microwave background, the furthest we can see that wall that you mentioned. And so the sphere here is being displaced, sort of as if it were gravity, you know, warping the space-time here. So.
Okay, and I'm at the right place. I'm behind the
You're not in it. So that's the problem. Yeah.
Okay.
Hey.
Great.
Yeah.
Oh, yes, I'm too excited. Monica, okay.
Actually, maybe I can start.
I'm too excited by the, yes.
Saying that we have introduced, in my mind, also artists in residence at CERN. So we have artists of many different kinds at CERN. So that would fit very well. So once, well, now I have no longer anything to say, but we could.
Well, so you're going to write a letter.
Okay, we now have time for questions, and it's the custom of the Nanovic Institute that we always begin with students. And so I wait for the first question from a student. I'm looking at some of my students in particular.
Do you think that there should be more of a focus on something like biology and biomedicine in the, I guess, universal scientific community rather than physics, given its applications to man or so?
Well, you also have a lot of applications from physics. Don't forget that. And I think in principle, everywhere you have physics inside. So don't ask this question to physicists. The answer is obvious. But now, Ernest, seriously, I don't think so, because what you have to allow is blue sky research. Mm-hmm. Very often, out of the blue sky research, things come out which you haven't imagined before. And also, don't forget, because of the length of the talk, I left out the medical applications. So there's a lot of spin-off from the science. And it's in the computing, it's in the accelerator, it's in the detectors, detecting technologies. All this can spin off directly to humankind. We should very well balance the different sciences. And it's always dangerous to go, this might be more interesting. Everybody else has science. No, we have to balance all the time. That's important.
Another student.
So this might be a tough question to answer, but what properties would you expect a scalar field that describes dark energy or dark matter to have as opposed to the Higgs field?
You're right. It's a very tough question. I don't know. Well, the first thing is, of course, it has to have speed zero. Okay. More I cannot say. I don't know. No, I have to admit. When I don't know, I don't know.
Yes, more students. picked at least one more student. Or I'll call him one of my students.
Is there talk of putting a synchrotron in like, Africa or other?
Yeah, South Africa. Yeah. But that's not the Big East.
No, it's not the Big East.
And that's South African one. So here, this is a really an international collaboration for the citizen.
But the South African one wouldn't be?
Not in a similar way, as far as I know.
Okay.
There's also talking about possibly one in in Iran. So we have to see how this works together with CERN, because Iran is meant for CERN.
So would the ultimate goal of everything be to generate a program that is kind of universal throughout the entire globe? You know, you've got CERN and now SESME. So I assume you want to create something that is uniformly across all countries, not just kind of two individual groups.
I don't think that's possible. You have to have countries who have also, at least in the scientific part, a certain vision to do something. You cannot just make a United Nations project out of it. You are right in the sense that if you go beyond the size of the LHC, it has to be a world project from the very beginning. But world project does not mean that all countries are involved. But you need the brains and the hands from many, many different countries. It cannot be done in one region only. It's too large then. That was also one of the things of my driving thinking on enlargement of CERN. Get more institutes aligned with CERN. But you need the whole world, but not all the countries.
You have another student here.
What's been your motivation to study physics and devote your entire life to it?
I was always interested in trying to understand what holds the world together, so to speak. What are the smallest particles, the building blocks of matter, what governs us, why we can physically exist. Yeah. That has always interested me. In school already, there I started with atoms. My diploma thesis was in nuclear physics, but then nucleus is much too large. So I went from nuclear physics to particle physics. And then when you get older, you get more experience. And then you try to, as the professor does, you try to keep the young people free of administration, free of as much as possible. Free of all this boring work, and allow them to do their scientific work more freely. So this was very natural for this.
So
there's a young person still.
Okay, but no,
sorry.
he was so eager.
Theoretical
and experimental physics
diverge
better in
CERN. Depends on the individual. If the theorists are working on topics which are related with experiments, then it's very easy. They work together. Yeah, very easy. And one inspires the other. Yeah? So somebody, the theorist has a certain idea what one could test, the experimenters will do it, and vice versa. Of course, there are also theories which are difficult to test. So the best theorists use, of course, take for theories which you cannot test experimentally. That was a joke. So then it's more difficult to talk with each other. But still, there is exchange. And it's needed, yeah? It's not only between these ones. Now we can select the
or D in here.
So one of the principles that was really important in unpacking the standard model was symmetry. And I suspect one of the principles that would lead you to think there's something beyond the Higgs field is an abhorrence of uniqueness or just something that's really singular. But are there any symmetry principles that lead you to think there are multiple scalar fields, or are there other concepts or principles that you're using to infer that there's something beyond the Higgs
field? Usually it's symmetry. And one of the key words here is supersymmetry. Although I know that some of my experimental colleagues no longer believe in supersymmetry. I don't know what's the case here. Because many of the parameters have already been excluded on the easy part. What is supersymmetry? Well, you know that more than 80 years ago, Dirac proposed antimatter. And when he proposed antimatter, he immediately doubled the number of particles, because each matter particle got a partner in antimatter. So it took only 3 years to discover it. At that time, it was faster. Now, supersymmetry. In supersymmetry, for each of the standard model particles, you introduce a sort of superpartner with an opposite spin statistic. So metaparticles become, so to speak, force particles in the spin statistics, and the force particles become metaparticles. Again, you double the number of particles. And this could solve, this could give a particle which could be the dark matter. The lowest lying supersymmetric particle looks around and doesn't find any partner in which it could decay, so it would be stable.
So you think, so even though there's no spin in the Higgs field, you're thinking there's a false or fake partner or other.
No, that partner would also have a partner. There would be more than one Higgs. But in supersymmetry, the lowest lying Higgs particle has very similar properties as the standard model. So that's the dirty trick. Because you have to measure very carefully, right, if you can distinguish it, if it exists. Now, we are talking about supersymmetry since 30 years, I do. So, as an experimentalist, I'm so used to it that I hope it's true. Existing, but okay. But these guys who are in the experiments, they don't find that it's a dual, despite the fact that I told them. Okay.
Yes. In your presentation, this was mentioned, but since its founding, what has been, in terms of dollars, the cost of CERN?
At the moment, the budget is 1 billion per year, Swiss francs or dollars per year. Okay? That's the present budget. Now, if you, of course, at the beginning it was much smaller. But 1 billion is not so much. 1 billion is less than the large universities. The ETH, Zurich, the UK universities, Canadian, many, many universities in the US. Have a much higher budget. Yeah. And after all, we are serving more than 12,000 scientists, and we have a huge infrastructure to do that. So, let's say 1 billion. Stable since, I don't know, let's say 10 years. At the point it was less. Let's say it started with much less. Let's say 20 years, 10 or 20, let's say 20 years for 1 billion. So this is all innovative, I have no idea. 20 years for 1 billion and 40 years for, on average, for half a billion. Would make 2 times 20 billion, correct? So 40 billion US dollars.
Thank you.
Well, it's good value for money. The VAT came out of it. That could also be, okay. You could also say, no, well, okay, I don't want it. Medical applications. Actually, the touch screen was first introduced at CERN and then unfortunately not continued. So somebody else afterwards introduced it again. But all this money is spent by now by 20 countries. But it's Please, it's more and more.
Okay, we have three questions here, so let's make them very precise. And, oh, actually, we have four. So, four precise questions.
And one non-precise one.
Yeah.
Up to you.
I am a physician, but I still think I did okay understanding you. My only problem is when you imagine matter, antimatter is 1 to 1. In your estimation, antimatter, dark energy is 75%. How do you estimate?
Wait a second.
Dark energy, antimatter.
You don't think dark matter and antimatter. Yeah. That's two completely different.
Okay.
Yeah. Now, if you produce matter out of energy, you always produce the same amount of antimatter. So matter and antimatter. And then if matter and antimatter meet, they are annihilated. So in principle, you should not exist.
What about the dark matter?
The dark matter, you, this is astrophysical and astroparticle physics calculations and measurements. For example, the rotation of the galaxies would not be possible without additional matter which we don't see. Yeah, that's one example. Or also the deflection of light.
Okay.
Deferred.
Mine was political, actually. I was wondering about sesame. So what are the mechanisms to enforce that the member states cooperate the same as member states cooperated at CERN?
You can only argue. You have no handle.
And CERN had no handle, right?
No. It's all motivation. You have to have people who want to cooperate. And partially it's also up to the to the management or to the council management, ultimately also to the president of the council to convince them to pay.
Yeah.
How about, mine's kind of political as well. How was the relationship with the CERN, the CERN management and the media and a couple of religious institutions when they were saying that this would create a black hole and destroy the entire planet, which they had no idea what was the experiment about?
I think the relation was good. At that time I was, that's not the reason. At that time I was the director general and I had to deal a lot with such things. So the key issue here is to take everything serious and to talk to the people and not say push. Okay. You have to take people serious and to argue with them. But there are three classes of people. One class which believes you immediately, you don't have to argue with them. One class which never believes anything what you are saying, forget it. That's not worthwhile the effort. And you find very quickly out these people. There are only a few. One is of them is German. And the biggest part are people with whom you have to discuss, and to present things, arguments, and you give examples of how things are working. And then you have to be honest all the time. Because then media believe you when you tell them, I don't know yet. I can tell you in a few hours or in a few days. You have to establish a relationship with the media. And I think it worked. We had a pretty good. But also, especially for the black hole, for the black hole business, we had people dedicated to answer questions on the web. So there was a web page where people could deal with their questions and then they gave the answer. It was quick and much in the
We just have time for your question.
I have a similarly related question. What was the motivation to bring the media in for First Light after the bubble in the magnets destroyed a section of the...
To bring media...
When the LHC was restarted, the media was there, so it wasn't a cold run. It was in front of live media. That was a very large risk.
There's always a risk, but if you... Nowadays, everybody tweets, not only presidents. And they tweet that all the time, and they go on Facebook, everybody knows, but things are getting out. People knew what I would say before I said it. So, then it's much better to be open. And much better to show people what's going on, even if there could be a failure. But it's part of the openness, of the transparency. And that is also part of the credibility and the establishing a relationship with the media. And what's really nice for science, and I'm not saying for CERN or for physics, what's really nice for science is that the media are so interested. Because it shows that there is some hunger outside in the society concerning research. Because the media would not be interested if they couldn't sell their products. Yeah. So this is fantastic. I mean, I would never have dreamt to read in UK newspapers, really daily journals, something about the Five Sigma, our threshold for calling it a discovery. It was in one of the UK papers, the normal journals. Isn't that a success? That's fantastic. I mean, people might have forgotten it, but they have agreed by this. And these people, you have them to some extent interested in research, and that's what counts. So this is why it was very, very, very important to have them there. And also to the announcement of the discovery. We didn't know, by the way, that we would announce a discovery until a few days beforehand. So it was an interesting time.
Well, okay. Professor Heuer, many, many thanks.